Hello, everyone.
I'm going to try doing some code with you and to show you how things work in Symfony 4, which are things that also work with Symfony 3.4. So let's go. Symfony 4 is going to be a revolution. I hope so. So to spread the word, we need your help. So if you like it, tell it. It's not about me. It's about the community and the work of the community. So you know, Symfony 2 changed a lot of things. Symfony 3 just made things way more robust with better processes. And Symfony 4 might completely change the way we develop applications and completely make it much more easier. So please tell everyone what you're going to listen to. If you like it, I hope you will. I'm Nicolas Grecas, and I'm, contributing to Symfony to make that happen. So let's go to the console now. Enough of that. I'm in a directory. There is nothing there. So we're going to, create a project. I'm using Flex. Most of the things I'm going to show you already work on Symfony 3.3. No other work only on Symfony 3.4, which is going to be released in 2 months with Symfony 4. So just Flex is so easy to bootstrap something and to demo that I have to use it. You'll be able to use it yourself, when upgrading your current application, because I hope you're doing upgrades every 6 months, like you should, just to be up to date and have the latest maintained version. So let me wire the internet. Might be better with connection, with only Wi-Fi. Let's go. So right now we are using the skeleton, which has a dependency, a very low set of dependencies. I'm not going to look at them really. So it's version 3.3 mostly. And we are going to change that a bit. I'm in Composer. I'd like everything, so I'm doing no updates because I'll do one single update. I'll do what I showed to some of you in the morning, which is adding Symfony LTS, which will constrain every single component to version 3 because I don't want to go up to master right now. It makes my demo easier, so doing that, what's that? Require. Okay, now I'm going also to require, let's say, this is Flex. So Flex comes with a naked Symfony, and we don't want to start that with that low set of dependencies. So I'm going to need the server, which is the way to bootstrap the PHP server easily. I'm going to use Twig. I'm going to use the profiler because the toolbar is nice. What else? I have the list. Yes, debugging tools. So debug, which provides the dump function you might already use, and we're going to use also together. And what else? It was annotations, because annotations are nice, and we want them. So okay. So we're ready for Composer updates. Just to replace, I forgot something, which is to allow unstable dependencies. So minimum stability Dave to allow 3.4, which is not tagged. So Composer requires this. OK, now done. So if you look at this quickly, you'll see that we have 3.4 versions of every Symfony component. And so we're ready to start our application. So I'm in this folder, so in the demo application. And let's start the web server. So now I have this web server running. So we run bin console server start. That's what makeserve does. We have a makefile that Flex provides. And so the makefile builds the recipe. And we have a working Symfony application. So it works. Don't be fooled by the exception message. This is Symfony displaying something. So we have something working. That's the default page. It means we have nothing to display. There is no default, you know, demo application anymore. So you have an exception saying, I have nothing to root for the slash root. So let's add something there. So who is using PHP Storm? OK. So let's do a controller there. I'm not used to PHP Storm, so let's do what? PHP file? It's not there. Anyway, what that? Let's call that hello controller. It's strange. What's that? Namespace app controller. Let's do class hello controller. And let's create a function which, let's say, hello action. And then return new response. I don't have auto completion. It would be great if it would. How can I wake up this? Ah, yes, now I have it. Response, hello world. So nothing unusual. Maybe only the fact that the controller doesn't extend anything. So I'd like to show you that we can just create a class and have something be ready. This is not working yet, of course, because we don't have routing configured. So let's do some routing. I'm going in the config. I have routes.yaml. And I just have to uncomment this to load the source controller folder as annotation based, and go back to this, and then add our annotation. Oops, sorry. What did I do? Ah, some shortcut I don't know. So, return root. It's name. We don't care for the name. Let's say it's just slash. OK. I need to use, what should I use? Root from annotations. Where is that? Maybe not that, but annotation, root, done. Will it be better? Not yet. OK, wow. So still nothing fancy yet. You know, we can replace that file and rewrite it in PHP. Let's do. So I'm killing that. And let's say rename that. So now I'm doing the same configuration, but I'm doing it using PHP. So there's something special that we merge in 3.4, which allows you to do configuration via PHP and easy like that. So you create a file within that namespace. You return a closure. And this closure takes an argument, which is a routing configurator. Let's call that root. It's a closure, return. And now we have this route object that provides things to, yeah, autocompletion. Let's import what type resource first. So what's the resource? It's the same as before. So we have the resource. And then what's the type? Annotation. Save, refresh. Let's do that just to be sure that I'm not cheating. It works. First step, so that's new. I don't know if that's going to be the new recommended way to do configuration. Fabian is not sure of that. But if you like it, you know, you have PHP Storm. You have autocompletion, so maybe it's easier to use. I don't know. You can do many more things with routes. So you can, of course, add routes. You can add collections. So let's say you have a collection. You can prefix the name of all the routes that you will put after that, and then you can add new routes, name and path. So the name should be foo, and the path maybe foo, and you can also add prefix there and say this is slash foo. So you cannot say that really easily in YAML. But here we created a collection. OK, like it's reads. Cool. Next. So let's do Twig. It's better to render things with Twig. So we're going to use the Twig object directly. So let's add, again, a constructor. The constructor should take a Twig thing, and let's call that Twig, of course. Up, we have Twig. So now we have Twig there. We need to render the content. So the content might be, this Twig render. Render what? Let's create some hello.html.twig file, and that's it. Do we need the context? I'm not sure we need. So let's do something else. Let's add the name. Let's add defaults. Up. It's equal, let's say world. And let's do that also. It's OK. So we have Twig. We are rendering something. Let's also create a Twig HTML file and base things. So let me just cheat and borrow this. Hey, just borrowing this. Let's use Twig. That's the thing. So git. OK, I just cheated. It doesn't work. Why? So we have the class, but we don't have proper configuration right now. So let's remove that. I'm just doing the same with YAML. So this is the default YAML file, but I'd like to construct it again with you. So how do you delete that? Anyway, I don't know. Ah, yes, there was a delete. So remove. So now we have this file. So I created this file before. So this file is exactly the same as using the same trick as we do for routes and that we did together for routes. So in this case, we created a new file in the configurator namespace of the dependency injection component. So same again. We do return a closure from that. And then this closure takes a container configurator. And this object, you can configure services. So we're going to use that. So we create services, and we create one, which is just the Hello Controller class. And we give it Twig as argument. I'm going back to this now. Hello, world. Yeah. While doing the checkout, we created so the base HTML just put some CSS in line. And then this is the Twig file that I created again. So it's just a title tag in the page. So let's continue on that. So there's something special there, and there's something new. So since Symfony 3.3, we recommend you to name your services after your class names. So here, we create a new service, which is called Hello Controller, so which is called like that. So this string, is it big enough? Yeah. So app controller. So that's the fully qualified class name of our controller. And we do set it as a service whose name equals the class of the service this way. So it saves you from finding a new name for this. Who is using that already? Cool. So all the other one, you can save yourself thinking and naming things. Yeah? You would name services as usual with using nouns and things like that. So you can do that. It's still working as usual. But if you don't need to, you don't have to. That's the point. So if I were to name this foo, I could provide it a class this way. And that would be done. Of course, the wiring doesn't work because the routing wouldn't look for this foo service. But OK, that's just a matter of configuration. So we can do that. Cool. Next step might be auto wiring. So who is using auto wiring? OK. So auto wiring is something that exists in Symfony 2.8. And it's very different since Symfony 3.3. In 2.8, it was magic. I won't tell more about it. In 3.3, auto wiring means that whenever you type hint something in your constructor, this container and the container builder will look for a service that has exactly the same name as the type hint. Straightforward, pretty predictable. If there is a service that is called PSR log logger interface, then this is the service you will get. Of course, there is one. And it's just an alias, a service alias, from this interface name to the actual monologue service. So there is one. I didn't enable log at the beginning, but we're going to do that together then. So it just works this way, and it works for your classes and for bundled classes. So in Symfony 3.3 and 3.4, so in Symfony recent version, we added aliases for the most common interfaces you already use in your class. So Twig environment, logger interface, there's big list, so I don't know that. But many things from security, many things from every single part of your applications. So let's use that. And the good thing is that now I don't need to care anymore about wiring Twig. It just works the same way. And I can again clear the cache, and it works the same way. So we saved my line. Cool. We can do better. We can do better because we just did that for the controller, but we can't, for one controller, but we can load all controllers. Let's do load. So to load the controller, you need to, and to load all controllers as services, we can just do that. Controller. OK, let me do it another way. We're just removing that. And here we need a namespace. PHP system tells us, so let's put a namespace there. And we need to tell it where it should find the classes of this namespace. And now we are loading all classes found in this namespace in this folder. And they will be available as services, all of them. And they will be all of them auto-wired. So again, clear the cache. Don't be sure we don't cheat. And it still works. Wow, nice. So now all your controllers are auto-wired. So you don't need to care about it anymore. Okay, another step. So I started without anything, but we can still extend something. Let's extend the abstract controller. So you used to extend the controller, but we have a new class, which is now called abstract controller. You can use any of them. I prefer this one because this one forces you to be explicit. You cannot use this container get and get anything without first telling I want this service and this one. So there's no more God object, so the container coming in and providing everything so that the review is just impossible and testing is just nightmare because you have to mock everything and you don't know what to mock exactly and it can change over time. So doing so removes this container get. Not exactly, but we'll see how. So now the good thing is that we don't need any more to do that because there is a helper to do exactly what we just did, which is this render, let's say, this hello controller. And it should do it. I'm sure the cache should burn. OK, still working. Cool. So let's do now a service. So create a new class. Let me cheat again. So OK for that. I'm just shipping you. OK. So what do we have now? Now we have this thing, which is a fantastic service that provides you one name at random. So you ask it name, get one, and it returns a random name from that. So now we need to ship that as a service and to use it in the controller so that, let's say, when no name is provided, so let's say we have null here, then we provide a name that is generated by our service. So let's call it name provider. So if there is a name, we use it. But as if there is none, we do get one. Of course, there is no such variable yet. So let's do it later. Can wire that. So let's go back there. So this file is still the same. Here we are going to do something a lot more, maybe not risky, but challenging. I'm going to load every classes of all my source folder as services. I'm going to do something else. I'm going to define defaults so that here, if by default, in Symfony 3 and 2 and since the beginning of Symfony 2, all services are created and are public. A public service is a service that you can get from the container. So if you have your container at hand, you can container arrow get and any service, and you get it if it's public. If it's not public, you cannot do that, but you can still wire it, so reference it in your configuration. So if you do add my private service, you can do that, but you cannot do container get my private service. You get an exception with that, which is nice because it forces you again to be explicit and to not use the container as a God object, as a service locator, the bad kind of service locator. So we want all our services to be private, so we are forced to follow best practices. So I'm going to use a new section that exists in 3.3, so you can use it already. So services defaults, and I'm going to just make them private. I'm going one more step. One more step means I'm going to auto-wire all the services by default. So now I'm still going to load everything there. So this is equivalent. The line I'm going to remove applies only to the classes loaded from this namespace. And now, with the default section, this is applied to every single service I could define in this file. So if I set another service here, because I need explicit configuration for it, then it will be also private and auto-wired. OK? So now we should have this one ready to be injected. That's not enough. I want something else. I want to show you that you can request a service as an action argument. Let's do. We take our name provider and we call it name provider. So we want that to work. We want the service. So the benefit of that is that now it's lazy. So if you have several actions in this controller, which is fine, then you might inject this name provider in the constructor argument, but then you will require Symfony to instantiate and create the service all the time for all actions, but maybe you don't need that for all actions and you actually need it only for this action, let's say. So now it's lazy. When this route is called, then the service is created. So that's what we want to achieve. So how do we do that? The way to do that is to add a tag to the service, to the controller service. So to add a tag, I can do it that way. So now I'm going to add a tag to this one specific service. So I can name it again. So this is its name. We are replacing actually the any services that load might have created. So load in this case creates this hello controller as a service, and then we replace. We replace the service by our own definition. And on this definition, I'm going to add a tag. And this tag is going to be controller.serviceArguments. So you know Symfony ships with a big list of tags which add behaviors to your application. And this is one behavior we added that is the behavior that creates an argument resolver per action. And this argument resolver is the name, the fancy name for the code that ships you and calls the method there and provides it our service. So let's call it. Hey, looks like it works. Cool. OK, now there is another thing in Symfony 3.3, which is called auto-configuration. So every bundle, your bundles, open source bundles, can now declare bindings between an interface or an abstract class or a class, actually, which means more generically a type, and a behavior. So you can say, whenever a service implements, let's say, abstract controller, then add it automatically this tag. And all bundles provide that. And the way to opt in to this thing and this auto configuration is to add and enable the auto configure flag. And this will be done for you. So this enables auto configuration for this class, which is not that useful because we know this class and we have precise control over it. But now you can do another thing, which is that. And this enables auto configuration for every single service found in this app folder, which means your classes, which means with this configuration, you create an event subscriber that implements event subscriber interface. And done, it gets events and it gets registered as whatever you declared in the get subscribed events. So you can listen to requests, you can listen to events that the form, you can, so you can do very easily things and you don't need to patch this file anymore. So I can again remove that. Wow, still working. Cool. So now we can use, let's add some configuration to our name provider. So let's add, let's say, a local to that. Let's say, OK, let me cheat because it's going to be boring. Is that? Yep. Maybe that was the other one. Okay, let's do this one. Okay, so let's move on this side. So now I just made a bit this service, this business logic a bit more powerful. So it takes a default local, and now you can have names based keyed by local. So French first names, you American ones. So this class requires a default local, so a string, and then you can get one with the local, and if you don't ship any, you have the default local that is applied. So that's the logic there, and so we have an issue with auto-configuration if we do that with our previous configuration. So if you remind, we had only that before. So now, because we have something the Symfony cannot auto-wire, because you know it's a string argument, so there is no type to look for. So we don't know what we can provide there. Then we can just, again, explicitly set a service and set, yes, this class and inject it, the default local parameter we created just above. So you can add parameters, of course, there. So now, again, now we have French. Cool. We can, let's go one more step. So let's say you can, you want to provide the default local this way. So we're going to look at this class, which is our .env file. So there we can define an environment variable and say, now I want US guys. Who is using that already? One? OK. So in Symfony 3 and 4 and with Flex, all infrastructure-related configuration will happen through environment variables. Why that? Because it's just the infrastructure that should tell you what is the database password, where is that file configuration file provided, where is the SMTP endpoint to send mails. So that's really the environment and the hosting provider that should ship you configuration for that. And it will, and usually it ships that through environment variables. So now you can just have Symfony be bound and be reconfigured automatically whenever this variable changes. And this is dynamic. It means you can have a booted Symfony pre-compiled. You don't need to clear the cache to change the database password anymore. This happens whenever the environment variable changes. So this is a great way. So in this case, we have a default local. Maybe it's not an infrastructure-related configuration. Maybe it is. So you have the same application, and you want to deploy it in several servers without changing anything in the source code. You can do it this way. It says, look at the environment to get that. So now we have this default local. Now let's say the default local might be something you might use in several services. So the default local is not a concept that is very specific to our name provider. Maybe the translation system needs also a default local. Maybe you have other services that are localized and that need this environment variable. So there is a way to create a convention. And again, this convention and everything I said about defaults, private, auto-wire, auto-configure, and the automatic configuration of things based on the interface that are implemented, they do only apply to services declared in this very file. It's per file. It's not global. It's just in this file because you added a line saying, I want to opt in into this automation. So now we can bind, not parameters. It's in default. So the concept I'm going to demo now is binding. So binding means you give it a name or fully qualified class name. So now I'm going to give it a name. And this says, whenever, while auto-wiring, you find an argument that has no value already defined and it needs value, then give it this. So we have a global configuration for our application. And now we can, again, remove that line. What's that? Unused binding. Sorry? Yeah. Name provider, default local. Mm-hmm. Maybe I did not try that enough. So do I have... So there, get one, I don't have any default, so it's OK. In this one, I have default local, and then I put, I did a mistake. Oh, sorry. Thank you. So, better, thank you. Cool. So now, hello, American guys. And I just need to reconfigure my environment. And I can switch to French. And there is no container recompilation, so I don't need to clear the cache. And the cache is not clear automatically. This is just dynamic configuration. So cool. So the .env file is the way to configure your development machine. Of course, in production, you will use real environment variables, either using Docker and using, you know, fast CGI parameters per virtual host configuration anyway. So don't use .env, of course, and it's not recommended. It's, in fact, disabled by default if you do things properly. So now we have binding. So we have one more convention, and we can forget again about, you know, going to configuration to do configuration. It's nice because now it allows you to just focus on doing code, following the convention you define there. And if you do, which is not really hard because you just need to do things properly, to use consistent names, to use consistent type hints, and to type hint everything, and to be explicit by type hinting. And so you're, by using best practices, you have automation out of the box. So that's double bonus. What's next? Oh, we can do something more. We can, let's say, make our name provider. This is just to show you another thing with environment variables. We can, let's, so now we have names that are just static there. So we can add a way to configure this. So we just did. So I added this name argument. And if there is one provided, we use it. And if there is none, we still use the defaults. So we can do something else now. And we can go through our services.php file. And I like to mix environment variables and this configuration, which means I want to have an array defined via an environment variable. So I'm using that. And this might be my environment variable. And this needs to be a string, because environment variables are strings. But let's make it a bit more fun. We're going to use UKNames. So let's call one James, one, let's say, Chloe, one, any English name? Daniel. Daniel is nice. OK, so we have three UKNames. This is JSON, so we don't want to inject the string. And the way to do that is you use a prefix in the environment variable. So this is already done for you here. I create a parameter, list of names. And this parameter references our list of names, but we have a prefix. And the prefix tells Symfony to process the value of the environment variable and to JSON decode it. So you do that. It's, again, fully dynamic. So if we change the .env file and we add a new name, we'll get it. And so in this case, I'm back to explicit configuration, because the list of names is really not a concept I want to create and to bind. But I can still mix things. So I can still do binding. So let me add again that. So it was default local. And here we say I want it to be default local. Cool. And now I'm going to use a named argument. So let's say on this service, there is an argument which is called names. And I want to put there our list of names arguments. I'm not declaring the default local, because this one is already declared. And we have a convention for that. And it doesn't work because there is no US because I did not change this one. So we have US and we are only providing UK. So, hey, cool. So I'm going over, but so JSON, what else you can cast to int? So if you want to force something to be an integer, you can. You can cast it to, you know, float, a string. You can also read the content of a file. So if you put file there, then the value of the environment variable will be considered as a file name, and Symfony will file get content, this file name, and put the content of this file inside this parameter. This allows you to deal with secrets. Because if you use Docker, if you use Kubernetes, if you use many, you know, container-based systems, they do provide passwords and secrets as a virtual file system and in files. So this is where you need to get the credentials. So using that, you're done, and you have secure auto-configuration for your secrets, so API keys, database, and things like that. OK, I think I'm going to stop there. A few more things. So let me just open a few slides. So we talked about PHP-based configuration. We talked about fully qualified class name service IDs. I didn't tell you, but every ID is now case sensitive. Of course, there's a backward compatibility layer. So in Symfony 4, it's going to fail if you do a case typo. It's the case for IDs and parameters. We did auto-wire by ID, which means looking for services by the name of the type hint of your services. We used PSF4-based service discovery, which is stating namespace and the directory. So we did that together. We used the service argument resolver to inject a service into an action. We used defaults. We used auto-configuration so that you don't have to tag your services manually. I didn't tell you, but we made all services, all your services private by default. So that's for your services. But you should know that in Symfony 4, if you don't do that, they will be private by default. So we can remove that line again. And many, almost all services, all services that are not explicitly declared as public will be private by default in Symfony 4, which applies to all bundles and Symfony Core. So you are going to have more work to do bad things. So if you do things better, you will be, you know, safer, things will work. Cool. That's what you expect from a framework, I hope. We use named arguments. We use binding. We saw that we can process configuration and environment variables. We did not go to step 3. So these are the features that I did not showcase. You can explicitly ask a setter to be auto-wired, but you need to add an annotation to it. So let's say you want to implement this logger-aware interface. You can create this setLogger method. And if you want the auto-wiring system to call that method for you and to ship it a logger for you without you doing anything, you just have to add this at required annotation. You can create service locators. And you can create explicit service locators. So there is an interface which is new, which allows you exactly like when you subscribe to events, so event subscriber interface, which has a static method that say get subscribed events. Then you have a method that you can implement and which is static and is called get subscribed services. And if you return an array from this method, and this array should be a list of PHP types, it means that you declare this class is using a service locator, and this service locator should contain only that. So it's breaking the bad thing of service locators because it forces you to be explicit, and you cannot fetch anything else that you did not ask for. So it's, again, a lot easier than to mock. About for advanced usages, you have this kernel class. Of course, you know about it because it's the entry point of everything. And this kernel class, if you make it implement this compiler pass interface, it will act as a compiler pass. So a compiler pass is an advanced concept that allows you to hook into the container building and compiling process so that you can reconfigure and change the configuration that maybe bundles did, maybe you did, maybe you want to add automation, maybe you want to add yourself some interface as registering an interface for auto-configuration. So saying, oh, this is my interface, and I want every class of this interface to be wired and tagged this way. So you can do that yourself just in one single class. The last three are more edge case, but still. In Symfony 3.4, we added this resettable services. A resettable service is a service that you can reset and that will be automatically resetted for you at the end of the request response cycle, so at kernel terminates. And why is it useful? It's useful and really useful because then you can add the Symfony kernel in a React or PHP PM loop. So you can have a single process, long-living single process, and you can have it serve several services, several requests, without killing the process and restarting again. This is what we do today. But using that will remove, will allow cleaning state between requests. So you can hope for 10th time more performance improvements. And OK, now the compiler is compiled in several classes, which is nice because it makes the command line a lot faster when you have a big container. And we also have an internal thing that you can use, which are lazy collections. Lazy collections are iterators, generators, in fact, so that you can for each something. And this thing provides you services, a list of services. And the services are created only when you hit the actual iteration where they are required. So this allows you to have a lazy list of services. And this is used internally, let's say, for listeners. So let's say we start with, so it's kernel request. Then we have all listener. We call them in order. And maybe the third one says, stop. I'm done. Let's stop. I don't need the other one to be run. And then with the lazy collection, they are not created at all. So it's faster. Thank you.